my pleasure to introduce today's year seminar speaker, Clay Schonkweiler from Colorado State University. Before I give the title of the talk, let me just mention, of course, we'll go for lunch as usual after the talk at Mandarin Block. Clay is giving another talk this afternoon at 4 o'clock. It's the MSS Colloquium talk sponsored by the IGL. That's in 314. And then we'll go for dinner this evening, 6:30 at the Bread Company. Let me know if you're interested. I'll make the reservation. All right, the title of his talk is The Symplectic Geometry of Polygon Space and How to Use It.
Thank you. So thanks for inviting me. Thanks, everybody, for coming. So I want to talk about symplectic geometry and polygons. And so here's sort of the basic idea is that I'm interested in really random knots, or more generally maybe random graphs. And if you want to have a theory of random knots, well, of course, there's various sort of ways that people have thought of to do this. And what I'm going to, you know, if you want to talk about, well, random diagrams or, you know, random other, you know, the Petaluma model, I'm going to talk about sort of random knots as coming from a theory of random curves. And this story sort of has a long history in the biology and polymer physics world, because we can think of polymers, these very long stringy molecules, sort of are very well modeled by random walks or random sort of objects of some variety. And so, for example, DNA can be knotted, as has been known for a long time now. Proteins can be knotted in some sense. And so people in the polymers world are very interested in, okay, well, you know, what's the space of possible conformations of a DNA molecule? And, you know, how random are the actual conformations that you can see? And so as someone who's a differential geometer, of course, if I want to understand this, the collection of possible conformations, I want to know, well, what's the geometry of this conformation space? Or, you know, maybe you want to think of it as a moduli space or whatever. And how can you use geometry to understand what's going on? And so the first thing that you do is you discretize and make it finite dimensional and say, okay, well, we're not going to deal with curves. We're going to deal with piecewise linear curves with some finite number of edges. And let's say all the edges are the same length. So that's what I mean by equilateral, is that all the steps are the same length. And when I say polygons, I mean they form a closed loop as opposed to an open chain. And so what I'm going to talk about for the next 50 minutes is, okay, well, the collection of such things has a symplectic structure. It almost has a toric structure. There's a little bit of funny business going on there. But nonetheless, that structure gives you really nice coordinates. And using those coordinates, you can do things like write down sampling algorithms, write down numerical integration schemes, proof theorems about certain things. I'm going to say a little bit about how you can use the coordinates to do interesting things. All right, so the sort of basic object is a random walk in three space or a random flight, using Raleigh's terminology. So I'm just going to think of this as a collection of n edges, all of unit length. And if it's just sort of a classical random walk, I'm just thinking of each of these edges as unit vectors and distributed uniformly and independently on the unit sphere. And if the edges is, you know, thinking of these as edge vectors rather than as sort of the points where the vertices are is nice because you've already modded out by translations, which you really want to do to make things compact anyway. But if you want the vertices, of course, you just take the partial sums of the edges and that gives you back what the vertices are. Okay, so that tells you that, well, the space of possible random flights is just a product of spheres. Well, the sphere is sort of the best, the two spheres sort of the obvious example of a compact symplectic manifold. It's, in fact, it's a Kähler manifold. And so this is a nice space, however you want to think about whether there's a differential geometer or Riemannian geometer or symplectic geometer or whatever. All right. So what are the, and that's, of course, easy to understand, easy to sample, easy to integrate over, easy to do anything that you want. And, of course, random flights have been well understood for a long time. If you're interested in loops, you're saying, okay, well, what's the condition? Well, since you're thinking of the edges as vectors, if the last vertex is at the same place as the first vertex, you're saying that the sum of all these vectors is the zero vector. And of course, this is really three equations because you have three coordinates here. And so this is a codimension three thing. And it gets a Riemannian structure from the, you know, the standard Riemannian structure on the product of spheres. Of course, 2n minus three-dimensional manifolds are not so good if you're an algebraic geometer or if you're a symplectic geometer. But if you divide by the group of rotations, which is three-dimensional, you're now 2n minus six-dimensional, which is even, which gives you a prayer of having a symplectic structure, which it turns out that you do. And that's sort of what I'm going to talk about. OK, so the basic idea is, OK, well, we understand random flights. And we can build random polygons out of random flights. And so the idea is that, OK, well, if I want an n-step polygon, I could take a k-step flight and an n minus k-step flight. And as long as the distance between their starting and ending points is the same, I can smush them together and get a polygon. So now, essentially, what you're doing is you're saying, OK, well, k-step random walks, easy. N minus k-step random walks, easy. Now I want the conditional probability distribution where I condition on these end-to-end distances being the same. And that's, in some sense, easy and in some sense hard. So the distance from the start to the end of a random flight has some probability distribution. It has a density function. And the density function is this kind of gross-looking thing. Well, the integral expression is nice. The finite sum expression is kind of nasty. But you can, you know, when you expand it out into this finite sum, you see that it's really a polynomial in L of degree n minus 3 because you have this L in the denominator and this power of n minus 2 on L here. And where does this come from? Well, so this, certainly this expression was known to Raleigh in the early 20th century. And this expression one can just sort of compute if necessary. Where does this come from? Well, it's basically a Fourier transform. You say, well, the end-to-end distance is some vector. It's the sum of a bunch of vectors on the sphere. If you look at just the z-coordinates, then each of those points on the sphere, the z-coordinate is uniformly distributed from minus 1 to 1. And so now you take a sum of those things. And so now, what's the probability density function of a sum of random variates? It's the convolution of the densities of the things. And so it's a convolution of a bunch of boxcar functions. You take the Fourier transform. That gives you this thing. And then you use this crazy theorem that says, well, the Fourier transform of the PDF of a projection of a spherically symmetric distribution is the same as the Fourier transform of the PDF of the whole thing. And so that's basically where this comes from.
What is L here again?
Oh, sorry. L is the distance from the start point to the end point. And so this
after
is
n steps.
After n steps, yes. Yeah, yeah. Okay. Yeah. So it, the dependence on n is the subscript. Yep.
Okay. So what is the
okay. All right. So, well, if you want, now, okay, so that was just a random flight end-to-end distance. Now we said, well, we can build a random polygon by taking two random flights with the same end-to-end distance. So you just take a k-step flight with end-to-end distance L, n minus k-step flight with end-to-end distance L. As long as these are the same, when you smush them together, you get a polygon.
Wait, what do you mean smush them together? They will not end the same point, right? You know, so it's
I'm just going to move them until they are.
I don't understand what that means.
So here's 1, 2, up to k. I have some end-to-end vector of length L here. Here's 1, 2, up to n minus k. I have some end-to-end vector of length L here. And then I'm going to identify this point with this point and this point with this point. And now when I put them together, I have one thing of length L.
You're modding out by rotations.
And I'm modding out by rotations. Yeah, so sorry, this end-to-end vector, I can just do a rotation until it's the same vector, and then I can. Only the length matters. Yeah.
That's interesting.
Yeah, so remember, I want to divide by rotations.
Okay, no, I get it.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I see.
another thing.
Yeah.
So this is building a random model for closed.
Yep.
But not simple yet.
No, 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 well, they're not going to be simple. I mean, well, with probability one, they're going to be simple, but yeah. Yeah, 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 yeah. Okay.
One second, but you're incrementing still, sorry, I'm just trying to understand your model. You're still incrementing by unit vectors all the time, right?
Yeah, so these are always unit vectors. Okay, so this is your probability density function from your polygon, and it's a piecewise polynomial of degree n minus 4, but you just say, okay, well, this is k minus 2, and this is n minus k minus 2, and so this is n minus 4. And you can just use this to compute, you say, okay, well, what's the, you know, if I have a 5 gun, I want to know, well, what's the expected distance between the first vertex and the third vertex? So I'm skipping 2. Well, of course, the first vertex to the second vertex is 1 because all my edges are length 1. But the first vertex to the third vertex turns out to be 17 over 15. And you know, you know the density of that distance. And so now you just integrate L times that function, and you get these numbers. I don't know what they mean. I would love to know what they mean. If someone has any idea what they mean. So a lot of these are not in lowest terms, just because I wanted the denominators across the rows to be the same. So like here, 1168 over 960, you could obviously reduce further. I've spent a lot of time plugging these into OEIS. I never have come up with anything useful. And it's not just for small n. You can do, you know, 112 GANs skipping 37 edges, and you get this horrible 500-digit, you know, integer over some other 500-digit integer.
Can you look for recurrences explicitly? I mean, besides using OEIS. The longer ones, it might be possible.
Yeah, not well. Not really. I mean, yeah, not really.
The angles between consecutive edges in your polygon, they're arbitrary, right?
Yeah, yeah, they're unconstrained, yeah. And it's, you know, it's not just distances between vertices. You can take any function of distances between vertices. So hydrodynamic radius is very well approximated by sort of the sum of the inverses of the vertex-vertex distances, and then you take the inverse of that whole thing, and you get this, you know, this is really strange to me. 7 over 6, 6 over 5, 5 over 4, 4 over 3, 3 over 2, 2 over 1. I don't know what it, I mean, you can write this down and see that that's what it is, but what it means, I have no idea. And so, of course, the questions to ask, like, especially when you look at this and this, is like, why the heck are these numbers all rational? That's weird. And, you know, where did this, you know, okay, it's in some sense kind of obvious this is degree n minus 4, but why is it degree n minus 4? And why is it a polynomial to begin with? And the answer is, well, because this is all secretly coming from toric stuff. So the idea is that, okay, well, now when you smush these two things together, there's a symmetry where you can just, okay, well, if you think of, you know, these things here, and you can just sort of bend like this, one around the other. So I'm trying to illustrate that in this picture here. You have your k-gon over here and n minus k-gon over here, and you can rotate around that vector connecting those two vertices. And of course, that's a symmetry of the space. And whenever you have a symmetry of a space, if it's, you know, symplectic and blah, 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 you expect to have conserved quantities, right? So it's just sort of, and okay, so in the hand-wavy sense, this is like Netto's theorem, and then the more, you know, explicit sense, this is really the Duisterman-Heckmann theorem, which says, okay, you have your symplectic manifold, you have a Hamiltonian torus action, then whatever the dimension of the torus is, you expect to have that many conserved quantities, which are really just the coordinates of the moment map to, well, really the dual of the Lie algebra of the torus, but just think of that as RD, right? And, okay, well, that you already knew, and the point is, well, the distribution is continuous and it's piecewise polynomial of degree less than or equal to the difference between M, which is half the dimension of the manifold, and D, which is the dimension of the torus. Okay, well, polygons, we already said they're 2n minus 6 dimensional, so that's your 2m. And if you have a symmetry, so subtract 1, you get n minus 4. Well, a piecewise polynomial of degree n minus 4. That's what we just saw. But of course, you see this and you say, well, OK, that's one symmetry, but actually there's lots of symmetries, right? You know, OK, I have a 5-gon. I can pick this axis and do this bending flow around it like this, but I can also pick this axis and do a bending flow around it. And if I had a 17-gon, I could pick a lot of, you know, pick my favorite vertex and choose all of these sort of chords emanating out of it, and I could bend around those. And those things are all symmetries, and they all commute as long as these axes don't intersect. OK. So in general, you have an n-gon, and you pick your favorite triangulation, and that gives you n minus 3 chords and n minus 3 of these bending flows. Which are guaranteed to commute because it's a triangulation. All right, so secretly, this is, you're supposed to think of this as being a toric structure on the space. So now let me say a little bit of symplectic geometry kind of fast. So we had this product of spheres was our space of random flights, symplectic manifold. You have a diagonal SO3 action on it. So you know, I say, OK, well, if I have a random walk, I have this guy and this guy. I can rotate around by this SO3. Of course, the SO3 is area preserving in H factor, so it's a symplectomorphism. And it's not too hard to see that it's actually Hamiltonian. And the moment map is just the sum of the vectors, which is awesome because the space we care about is exactly the inverse image of 0 under this moment map. And then, OK, well, you have a Hamiltonian Lie group action on a symplectic manifold. And you are interested in the inverse image of 0 under that moment map. You can divide by the group. And what you get is something called the symplectic reduction or the symplectic quotient, which is going to be, oh, I lied. It's sometimes a symplectic manifold. It's certainly always a symplectic manifold, except it finitely many points. So it's, if you like, a symplectic orbifold or something. So, you know, OK, the polygons mod SO3 is this space I'm going to call Poln. And it has a sort of canonical symplectic structure coming from the symplectic structure on the product of spheres. OK. And so it, in fact, it fits into a bigger picture. So I'm seeing this as a symplectic reduction of S2 to the n, which itself can be seen as a symplectic reduction of the n by 2 complex matrices by the torus of diagonal, you know, elements in UN. And you can, it turns out you can go the other way around and instead sort of take the reduction by U2, which is just supposed to think of as a circle bundle over SO3. And you get the Grassmannian of two planes in CN, and then you take the residual torus, so you've already used one of the circle factors from here and here, so you have a one less dimensional torus, and you can go down this way as well. So that's sort of a bigger symplectic picture that I'm not really going to talk about so much. I'm focusing on this part right here. This afternoon, I'll talk a little bit about the Grassmannian, you know, so there's a polygonal interpretation of the Grassmannian, which is very nice. And so I'm going to talk about that this afternoon. OK, so the upshot is that, OK, well, if you looked at your triangulation, you have these chords, they have lengths, and you bend around you do these rotations around these axes, and you get dihedral angles between, you know, this triangle and this triangle. And those give you a system of coordinates which are all uniform. So the lengths of the chords and the dihedral angles are all uniform on their domains. And basically, the proof is to make sure that Deutschmann-Heckmann actually applies. Well, there's a little bit of there's a little bit of stuff that you actually have to do because this torus action is sort of not defined when one of these chord lengths is zero. Like, if the chord length is zero, what do you mean bend around the zero vector? But aside from that, you know, it's basically Deustermann-Heckmann, which says, okay, well, the moment map is a piecewise polynomial of degree m minus less than or equal to m minus d. Well, m is n minus 3, d is n minus 3, so you have a continuous piecewise polynomial function of degree 0. You know, it's a constant, right? So that tells you that the density of these function of these d's on their domain, whatever it is just some constant, multiple of Lebesgue measure, really. And so, okay, well, what is the domain? Like, what are the constraints on these links? Well, the answer is that they have to satisfy triangle inequalities. You know, this is a side of this triangle here, where this side is length 1, this side is length 1, and this is whatever it is. So, and likewise, it's a side of this triangle, where this is d1, this is 1, and this is d2, and d2 is also involved in this triangle. We have d2, 1, and 1. So you have a system of triangle inequalities. So for example, d1 has to be between 0 and 2, so it can't be smaller than 0, it can't be bigger than 2. Likewise for d2, so that's from the outer triangle. And then the inner triangles give you these three inequalities here. And so the space of possible d's for 5 guns is this pentagonal planar region. And again, the distribution of d's is just the uniform distribution. Well, some power of 2 pi times the uniform distribution. But if you're looking at the probability distribution, you don't care about that constant factor up front. And then the point is, these really give you coordinates on the space, because you can go from d's and thetas back to getting a polygon. So how do you do that? Well, if I have my d's, say in this case d1 and d2, I know how to build my three triangles, because I know, you know, side determines triangle. So I have 1, 1, and d1, d1, 1, and d2, d2, 1, and 1. So I know those triangles. Okay, I just put the first one in some standard position, and then I glue the second one to the first one according to whatever that first dihedral angle is, and then I glue the third one to the second one according to whatever that dihedral angle is. And then I'm left with a polygon. Of course, it's only up to translation and rotation, because I have no information about the orientation of this thing. And there's a little bit of ambiguity, again, like if one of these d's is equal to 0, like what do you do? But that's going to be some positive codimension subset, which from a measure theory perspective, you don't care about. And so the point is, the volume form in these coordinates is super simple. It's just that. So if you have some function of d's and thetas, of course, it's very easy to integrate it against this. And if you want a sample, then you just need to sample the d's uniformly and the thetas uniformly. And of course, the thetas are easy to sample. They're all just between 0 and 2 pi uniform. But the d's, well, they're supposed to be uniform on whatever that moment polytope is. And so with this choice of triangulation, the inequalities that d's have to satisfy are always exactly these. So the first and last are kind of special, and the ones in the middle just satisfy the obvious things. And what you get is something that's not exactly symmetric. It's a little bit sort of weirdly, you can see in this picture, it's a little bit weirdly asymmetrical. But okay, so this you don't have to worry about, this you don't have to worry about. These inequalities in the middle, well, this one, you look at this and you say, oh, well, if I change coordinates to look at the differences of the di's, then this difference is just between minus 1 and 1. That's just on the cube. That's easy. This one, it turns out, is sort of the weird inequality to get your hands on. So if I want to do sampling, well, what am I going to do? I'm just going to make that change of coordinates. So now I have these si's, which are the differences of consecutive di's. I'm just going to sample the si's uniformly on the hypercube. And so that's automatically going to satisfy this, this, and this. So the only thing left to check is this inequality right here. And then you prove a little theorem that says, well, if you sample the S's uniformly on the hypercube, then they'll satisfy sort of those other inequalities with this probability. So n to the minus 3/2, basically. So this tells you, you know, if you want to generate a point in the space of polygons, you're going to have to sort of sample points uniformly in the sphere approximately n to the 3/2 times. You'll get a good one then, and then you'll build the rest of the thing. And all the other pieces are linear in n, so the whole thing is sort of expected time n to the 5/2 to generate a random polygon. And it's, you know, here's all the code you need to do the hard part. I mean, there's some more code to build the polygon out once you have the D's, but like, okay, random diagonals, this is just uniformly sampling in the sphere, easy. This is just checking once you have the D's, well, do they satisfy those other inequalities? And so random sample is just, well, you take a random diagonal, you check whether it works. If it doesn't work, you do it again, and you keep going until you've found one that you like. So when your sampling code is that short, it's fairly easy to know that you did it right, which is good, right? And so here's an example of an experiment that we did and have really no idea why. So we've sampled, oh boy, I don't know, millions of 60gons. And then we just ran Homfli, you know, computed the Homfli polynomial of each one of these things. And then, so this is, what is this plot? So this is a log-log plot of the frequency. So this is the unknot, the most frequent thing you get among 60gons is the unknot, and its probability is whatever it is, like 0.7 or something. These are the, you know, left-handed and right-handed trefoil knots. This is the figure eight, you know, 5.2 and 5.1 and blah, 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 right? So, and of course, you first generate the plot without the line, and you say, gosh, that looks linear. So then I just computed the best fit line, which was something gross, but I said, well, it's very close to this. So here's, you know, I don't know what it means. When we did this, we actually got about 6,000 different Homflies. So if we had kept going, eventually sort of there's a lot of ones where it's just like one, you know, one occurrence of that Homfli polynomial. So this is sort of cheating by chopping it off after 1,000 instead of doing all 6,000. Why is this happening? I don't know. Is it something real or is this, but it's strangely compelling.
Is it very different if you try to think 80
No, okay. No, it's, yeah, it's the same, yeah. Yeah, 60 was just, yeah.
What's the complexity of checking for the
knot? Oh, that's annoying, yeah. I mean, computing. Well, so we generated these things and we just have them as, you know, I forget if they're stored as vertices or edges. I think they're stored as vertices, actually. And then we feed it into, well, some iteration of Ken Millett's Homfli calculator. And that's sort of the slow part. Like,
that's what I was wondering.
Yeah. And in fact, there were I think, something like 42 of these were numerically singular enough that the Homfli calculator said, I don't know what it is, but 42 out of, you know, however many million is. We just sort of threw that away. So, I mean, this is, you know, the quick and dirty computation. But yeah, certainly computing Homfli is the hard part of this. And of course, Homfli is not a perfect knot invariant anyway. So where did this n to the 3/2 come from? That's sort of what's making this work. And it's in some sense just a computation, but it's kind of compelling. So I want to, and I don't really know, it's compelling, but I don't know exactly what's happening. So I want to tell you the story, and then hopefully one of you can say, oh yes, it's just this. So we're interested in this moment polytope, and the volume of this thing is known. It's this weird partial sum, which turns out to be this slightly less weird integral. And so we just want to know, okay, well, what fraction of the volume of the cube is this? Just for large n. So where here, okay, sinc is sine x over x. which of course goes to zero when n is very large. So we're just going to do a Taylor expansion around zero. After making the substitution, x equals y over root n. So I'm changing variables from x's to y's. And so that term x squared, which was sitting up front, turns into a y squared over n to the 3/2. So that's secretly where the n to the 3/2 is coming from. So now, okay, so we had this power of sinc x, which is sinc y over root n. You do the Taylor expansion of that, you get something that looks like 1 minus y squared over 6n plus lower order terms, or higher order terms, rather. Well, lower order in n. Okay, well, the limit as n goes to infinity of 1 minus something over n is just e, you know, to the n is just e to the minus y squared over 6 in this case. So this integral is going, the integral from the previous page turns into this integral, which is easy, and you just get, you know, some constant factor times 1 over n to the 3/2. So that's where the n to the 3/2 comes from. Of course, you can ask, like, well, where the heck did that formula come from? And the answer is, well, the partial sum formula comes from the symplectic geometers. I think I listed 5 papers here, and there's, I think, more, who computed the symplectic volume of the space of equilateral polygons to be this, using localization theorems and wall crossing arguments and blah, 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 right? And then if you stare at this for 2 years, you realize that this, you know, these sorts of sums are actually, you know, evaluations of these Dirichlet-type integrals. So you can actually find this formula in a book of Edwards from 1922. Of course, not written with sigma notation, but anyway. So that's where that sinc integral is coming from. And this is interesting because it looks a lot like a slab volume computation. So again, if we look at S2 to the n, that's toric symplectic, where the torus is just rotating around each z coordinate. The moment polytope is just the hypercube given by the z coordinates of the edges. And then if you look, so in general, if you look at sort of volumes of central slabs of hypercubes, you get this formula of Polya. So I'm looking at points in the cube where the sum of the coordinates is between minus a and a, so that's central slab, and it's this formula. And again, this is just, you know, this is really the Fourier transform of convolution of boxcar functions. Okay, so again, that's the same formula from the previous slide. When you plug in a equals 1, you get this thing, and you compare it to the volume that we had, which is this thing. And again, you're supposed to think of these as happening in Fourier space. Well, when you multiply by x squared in Fourier space, you're supposed to think of this as taking two derivatives back in the original space, right? So somehow the volume of our normal polytope is like the second derivative of, you know, or something involving a second derivative of these central slab volumes. Why? I don't know. It seems compelling. And if, you know, if it really is the derivative in some reasonable sense, does that mean that the moment polytope is some sort of collection of hypercube slices, which would be great because you can understand hypercube slices pretty well. And you could potentially do better than just this rejection sampling. You could just say, well, I understand this polytope really well, and I can just sort of sample it directly. So that's my question, which I am a little bit stumped by. Like,
presumably you've trapped this in some lower easy cases and it works or something?
What to say. Yeah, I mean, in the lower dimensional cases, it's sort of easy to see the moment polytope as sort of you took one of these slabs and sort of cut something off. But that doesn't really seem like taking a derivative to me. I don't really know.
But
I guess that's what I was
saying. The last question, it seems very concrete, right?
Yeah, well, I mean, so for example, if you think in the n equals 5 case, we had this thing. I guess I don't really see an obvious way in which this is a bunch of hypercube slices. I don't really see how to answer my question in any case. In the stupidest possible case, the n equals 4 case, it's like, yes, a segment is a slice of the square, right? Done. I don't really know other than that. Let's see, how am I doing on time? Some other questions. I mentioned algebraic geometry, and so I showed a version of this diagram before, where I had, okay, these are n by 2 complex matrices, S2 to the n, polygon space, Grassmannian, and these were all symplectic reductions. And of course, if you like, by Gelfand McPherson, like symplectic reductions, you can also realize in the case where everything in sight is a complex variety as GIP quotients by reductive algebraic groups. So you can say, okay, well, n by 2 complex matrices, I have this action by diagonal matrices in GLN, which is an algebraic torus. If I take that GIT quotient, I get n copies of P1. And if I take n copies of P1 and mod out by the isomorphisms of P1, I get down to polygon space. And what's the connection to the previous story? Well, before, this was the symplectic reduction by SO3, which is the maximal compact subgroup of PGL2. And likewise, this was a symplectic reduction by U1 to the n, which is the maximal compact of C star to the n. And likewise here, this was U2, which is the maximal compact of GL2, and this was U1 to the n minus 1. So there's this whole algebraic geometry side of the story. And somehow, it's not obvious to me how to bring measure theory into this version of the story. And so my question is there a way to bring measure theory into the story, and then we could understand random polygons sort of from the algebraic perspective rather than from the symplectic perspective. The symplectic is great because you say, okay, well, symplectic manifolds have a canonical volume form because you have this symplectic form. You wedge it up n times, you get a volume form. That's what it means to be a symplectic form. And when you have a volume form, of course, you have a measure, and there you go, you're in business. But in this sort of the algebraic side of things, it's not so obvious to me, at least, how to bring measure theory into the picture. And the reason I would like to do that is because you can just replace C everywhere in this picture with R, and the whole thing goes through. Now you have n by 2 real matrices, you have RP1 to the n, you have PGL2R, the Grassmannian of two planes in Rn, and then this space down here is equilateral n guns in the plane, which I would also be very interested in. And so the question is really like, either you say on the previous slide, okay, well, I can actually sort of understand the measure of the space at the bottom using algebraic ideas and just translate those complex algebraic ideas hopefully to the real algebraic. Of course, complex to real is like the hardest thing you can possibly imagine. Or maybe there's another way to get at the measure theory in this picture, some analog of the sort of symplectic story that gave you the measure theory before. Is there something that you can do that gives you a handle on this space down here from a measure theory perspective? That I would love to have more ideas about. So another thing that I'm very interested in is, okay, well, fine. You understand random polygons. That's great. You can sample them. You can do numerical integration. You know, you can do lots of things. But what about, you know, random theta curves or random, you know, K33s or random, you know, a lot of polymers don't occur as rings. They occur as these networks, these more complicated graphs. Or if you're interested in something like rubber is just some gigantic, horrible nightmare of a network. And so is there some version of the story for polygonal graphs? So you say, okay, well, I have some particular graph, maybe it's a theta curve or something, and I say, okay, well, each edge in the graph is some specified number of edges. How do I sample that thing sort of randomly with respect to the right measure? And this is interesting both from the perspective of, okay, well, a lot of biopolymers like DNA, you know, appear in these networks, rubber appears in this network, and then also a lot of people are really getting into synthesizing polymers with non-trivial topology. So this is actually the Tezuka lab, maybe a year or two ago, synthesized a K33. This was an unbelievable experimental design. They had to do something like 18 rounds of purification and titration to, you know, they had all these products that they didn't want and they wanted to get rid of. And then at the end, they thought they should have this and this. And the question is, well, how do I distinguish this from this? And sort of all the, what they wanted to do was they say, okay, well, if we knew sort of what the expected, what did they actually compute? The radius of gyration, actually. They said, well, we can compute the radius of gyration or the squared radius of gyration. Can we figure out what the expected radius of gyration of this is versus this? And if they're different, we could actually separate them. And then so they used some more or less physics-y version of the story to say, to figure out, well, we know kind of what the expected radius of gyration of these things are, and we can actually distinguish this from this. And of course, in general, people are very interested in these synthetic polymers with wacky topologies because they have sort of unusual material properties. And so it would be really nice to develop a theory, sort of a mathematical theory of these things that could then inform, you know, and for example, like it was coming from the theory that they were actually able to see that they had actually created what they had set out to create. Okay, so I don't think people will complain too much if I end a little bit early. So thanks for listening.
Great, thanks. Are there any questions?
Yeah.
Yeah, early on you showed this result that Raleigh knew about whether it was first programmed or not.
Mm-hmm.
This relies on being in free space, if I understand correctly, to get that boxcar.
Well, yes. Raleigh, of course, also knew some version of the two-dimensional thing, but the two-dimensional thing is worse. Because it's some weird integral of Bessel functions as opposed to integral of sinc functions. So let's see if we can find this. Here. So here you have this integral of sinc functions, which you can actually evaluate explicitly if you want to. The corresponding thing for random walks in the plane has, it's more or less the same thing, but with J0 instead of sinc. And those integrals, of course, Mathematica can do it when n is like 1 or 2. and of course it can do it numerically, but like it, you know, even I think n equals 3, you plug this into Mathematica and it says it just keeps going and eventually you get sick of it. Maybe you could do better than I could, but when I tried to do it, it was.
I'm pretty sure I know where the code gets getting lost. It's not going to be bad.
So these are Bessel functions instead of sinc functions, which makes it a lot more annoying. Yeah.
So I just have a question. So I'm from the symplectic geometry side.
Uh-huh.
And for us, sometimes, so you've done like, you start all the diagonals started from one vertex.
Yep.
From our point of view, sometimes that's not the best choice.
Yeah.
Sometimes the other choices are better.
Yep.
I was wondering if you looked at those other choices or whatever.
Well, yeah, so the other, I mean, in some sense, like for the hexagon, you know, I did the one from one vertex, but of course, in some sense, this one is better,
yeah.
Right? And of course, the one polytope is a little more symmetric when you do this. The reason that we did the one from one vertex was just because it was, we could very compactly write down all of the triangle inequalities, wherever they were, here, right? Whereas, you know, in general, it's not so clear to me what how to.
There's an A obvious choice of this for any number of sides. Where
yeah. Right, yeah, so what does this mean when you have an odd number of sides, or, yeah. But yeah, I think, I strongly suspect that if you chose a different triangulation, you would get sort of a rounder moment polytope, which you could better rejection sample, at the very least. Like, it, you know, the problem is, like, in these coordinates, this gets sort of long and skinny. And you change coordinates to the S's, and it becomes more round, and so it's a relatively large fraction of the unit cube. But I strongly suspect you could do even.
I see. That would sort of be your goal, is to get, fill up as much of the cube as, or something.
Well, I mean, not of course, it can't be the cube, because you know the fraction. I mean, the volumes are going to be the same under whatever the change of coordinates are. But if you could see, oh, well, this actually sits inside of, you know, the cross polytope, and it's, you know, like, you know, 1 over root n of the cross polytope or something like that. That would be, yeah, I strongly suspect that one can do that. I've tried a little bit and sort of gotten nowhere. But yeah, I agree that other triangulations should definitely be better.
Well, yeah, I wasn't quite that strong, but could be.
No, I mean, this like I said, this is weirdly asymmetric and sort of long and skinny, and yeah, I don't like this, except that I can write down this very simple system of inequalities that I understand reasonably well, and it's obvious to me what change of coordinates to make. But yeah, that's, I'm not wedded to it. I would be happy to choose a different one if I understood it.
Any other questions? All right, well, let's thank Clay again.